Thank you for joining us one more time. God bless you. Let's pray together. Father, we are grateful because you will not hide from us. You will not allow us to seek you in vain. Please, Lord, we seek your face. Please speak to us in the living echoes of your word and cause your word to transform us and deal with our issues. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God's word is the most singular, most important thing. It is what made the universe. It is what God uses to do his work. And if you wanted to walk with God and be successful in life, then you must pay heed to his word. God will not do anything. Don't listen to anybody who is telling you that God is working without his word. God does not work without his word. Let that be clear. Last week we said that God's word is his messenger. Let's go again and read that verse in Psalm 107 verse 20. Psalm 107 verse 20. The Bible says, he sent his word, and his word healed them and delivered them from their destructions. Whenever a man has a need, whenever a man has a problem, whenever a man has something that he needs salvation from, it, deliverance, and he cries to God, God will not do anything but to send his word. He sent his word. His word is his messenger. His word is his agent. He sent his word to go and do whatever he wants to do. And this word, he has magnified it above his name. It is not possible for the word of God to fail. The whole universe is upheld by the word of his power. His word contains his power. His word contains his anointing. God's word cannot fail. If he has said something, he will do it. He sent his word. If God gives you his word, go and sleep. It will come to pass. You may think there's a delay. God does not delay. 1,000 years in his sight is just like an evening. He has a purpose for everything he does. He has a purpose for every word he sends. Let me make it categorically clear to you. If it's not the word of God, then it's magic. Whatever happens there is not God. If God must walk, he sent his word and healed them and delivered them from their destruction. Are you being destroyed, my friend? Are you sick and need healing? Do you need to see progress? Do you need to see God work in your life? Because he sent his word and his word healed them. And let me show you what he said in the book of Isaiah, chapter 55. These are very serious preambles. But we must lay it down because many people are beginning to put their trust in something that is not the word of God. And their lives are not changing. And their lives are not getting better. Hallelujah. The Bible said in verse 8, verse 7, said, let the wicked forsake his way, and the righteous man his thoughts. Let him return unto the Lord, for he will have mercy upon him. And to our God, for we will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain cometh down, and the snow from heaven, and returneth not thither, but watereth the earth, and maketh it bring forth and bud, that he may give seed to the sower, and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall never return unto me void. It shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the things whereunto I sent it. Hallelujah. You have to listen to carefully. And we cannot do an exhaustive study of this passage, but this is a great passage. That the difference between you and God is that your ways are not his ways, and your thought are not his thought. Man is wicked because of the way man thinks, of the way man is made. Since after the fall. So let the wicked forsake his way and the righteous man forsake his thoughts. Your ways come from your thoughts. If your thoughts change, your way will change. Let him return unto the Lord. And he will have mercy upon him. God will not show you mercy arbitrarily. If you will not repent, he will not turn back to God. He will not change the way you think and your ways and come into the way. Then, God does not have any allegiance to you. Of course, he's sovereign. And he says, I will show mercy upon him, he will show mercy. But at a point, you need to respond to him. God will abundantly pardon. He will. If you turn to him right now, if you're a wicked man, if you're a man of iniquity, you turn to the Lord now and forsake your thoughts. If you're an unrighteous man and forsake your way, then the Lord will have mercy on you and abundantly pardon you because you turn to him. He said, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, said the Lord. So the trouble is that the way God thinks and the way we think is not the same. And that is why our ways and his ways are different. That is the big gulf. And it is the gap is as far as the heaven is from the earth. God is so sublime. God is so holy. God is everything that is good. And we're everything that is bad, unless we begin to grow towards him. But the major thing is that our thoughts, and our thoughts can be captured in our words. So God's mind is found in his word. And when a man begins to read the word of God and study the word of God and begins to think the word of God, then that person begins to live according to the word of God, and success will come. He said, as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain cometh down and the snow from heaven, these are very strong figures. As the rain cometh down and the snow from heaven, and returneth not thither, but waters the earth, and maketh it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. The rains come down from heaven. The snow comes down from heaven. And they come to the heaven to do a work. When the rain falls, if it's not a rain that God wants to use to do punishment, and therefore will cause an erosion, but the rain comes to water the earth, so that the earth can bring forth something from the earth. When the snow comes down, it waters the earth. And the purpose is that this earth may bring forth and bud. You see, it doesn't return again to God. The rain does not hang halfway and go back. It comes to this earth, waters the earth, so that the seed that has been sown in the earth can spring forth and bring forth, so that man can have both seed and bread for eating. We're going to come to that. The word of God is we're going to be looking at the nature of the word of God. You know that the word of God is also seed. The word of God is also bread for eating and seed for sowing. But let's not get there yet. But that's how the word of God is. It's like rain, it's like snow that cometh down to this earth to water it, to make it soft, to fill it with moisture so that the earth can bring forth every seed sown into it. So the Bible said, so shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void. It cannot come back to God empty and say, sorry, sir, I couldn't accomplish that which I please. And it shall prosper in the thing whereunto I sent it. God's word prospers in whatever God sent. So God sends his word. Like the rain is sent from heaven. Like the snow is sent from heaven. And because the rain and the earth come to the earth to be a definite work, God's word also is sent forth to go and do a definite work in every life, in every situation. And that word cannot return to God void. It doesn't return to God empty-handed. It doesn't return to God with excuses. But it shall accomplish that which God who sent it pleases. It shall prosper in the thing which whereunto I send it. I'd like you to make up your mind, friend. Whenever God sent his word, the word of God prospers in whatever the word of God was sent to do. So I would like you to note, very crucial, that the way to salvation is not first and foremost to run here and there, but to sit down and receive this rain and receive this word of God. Once you do and it enters your life, friend, it will never return to God void. Human beings are restless people. Human beings, they like to make boasts and claims. But let me say to you again, God has a messenger. God has an agent. It is His word. There is nothing God will do. Even when the whole earth spoiled and God wanted to repair it, God didn't struggle with anybody. He sent His word. There is no situation in which you have found yourself which God wants to work that God will begin to struggle with that situation. No, He just sent His word, and His word will never return to Him void. It will prosper in that thing that God has sent His word to do. So can we settle down? We're going to be looking at how do I find the word? Because this Bible is not the word of is the word of God, but it's not the word of God. You may have a very big Bible, like this, my good one, and yet you will not have the word of God sent to you. So we'll be looking at this in a little bit detail, because if you don't receive the word of God, nothing has happened yet. Even if you receive it in your head and it has not descended to your heart, which is the soil where it is planted, nothing has happened. So what is the word of God? So the first thing I would like to say to you very clearly is that the word of God is not our human words. Our human words are made of alphabets. I don't know how the etymologists or whatever they call them arrange words and have languages and have phrases and have letters. I don't know. I don't want to delve into what I don't know. But the words you speak to give instruction to a brother, to give instruction to his and say, go and do this for me. He hears it, and if either he obeys or not, this word that I speak to you is letters, the words, I mean letters, the alphabets they put together. W-O-R-D is word. W-O-R-D. These are alphabets. They put it together, they form a word. Several words form a phrase and then sentences. And a man can understand and go. Now, God also has a word. God's word is His expression. It is not merely words. It's not merely syllables. It's not merely alphabets. No. God's word is sent. And God's word is sent to do a quantum of work. And no word of God is empty of power. Otherwise, it cannot accomplish what God wants to do. So, in John chapter 6. Let's go there quickly. And I don't know whether I can be able to tell you what the word of God is particularly or very, very, very articulately, but I'm trying my best. Because sometimes when we are speaking our own words, we think that our own words is the way God also speaks. No, God's word is not ordinary alphabets they put together. No, no, no. The Gospel of John, chapter 6. Verse 63, Jesus was speaking somewhere and the people misunderstood Him completely. The Bible says, it is the spirit that quickeneth. The flesh profited nothing. The words that I speak to you, they are spirit and they are life. Hallelujah. The words that I speak to you, they are spirit. They are not flesh. They are spirit and they are life. If you catch that quickly, so when God speaks, He speaks spirit, not just mere words that have no power. And because God is at the back of every word He speaks, in fact, the word of God is God Himself going forth to accomplish a purpose. It is not flesh, it is spirit. It's not carnal flesh. It's not those words, letters you see in black and white on a book. No. That's why if you carry this Bible now and you keep reading it and think you're reading the word of God, no, you're reading the letters. There's a spirit behind the letter. That is the real word of God. And when that word of God comes to you, the Bible says, the words I speak to you, they are spirit and they are life. They are not dead. They are not inactive. They are not weak. They are not just words. They are not just words. They are spirit and they are life. They convey life. They quicken. They cause an effect. They do a work. It's as if whenever God speaks, God Himself is the one going there and going to do a definite thing. It's not just playing. So it's not a matter of semantics. It's not a matter of a very fine elocution. No, 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 no. It's not a matter of an orator. The word of God is not just oratoria. It is spirit. It's life. It's like somebody is being sent forth to go and do a work. And he said that person will never return to him void. We look at the word of God as the Lord Jesus. We look at the word of God as the Bible. But let me say to you that the word of God is life. It is spirit. It's not letter. It's not these words you see in black and white. No. You have to have an insight to receive it. But once it comes to you and you receive it properly, then you are in business. So friend, I don't know what is troubling you. I don't care what is troubling you. I don't know what is making you sad. I don't know what is making you looking dejected. And you are thinking that you have to pay so much for it. No, brother, if the word of God on that subject matter comes to you, so I will encourage you, sit down. Cry to God. Ask him to send you his word. If he opens it for you and sends you a specific word and you grab it, my friend, that is the end of that matter. He has sent it and it will never return to you void. To return to him void. Try it. The trouble of our generation is that we believe that there are some very few places you can run to when you have problem. And so many people have been misled. No, it's not like that. Every saint, no matter how young that saint is, as long as you are born again of the Holy Spirit, you can open up and receive the word of God. And when you receive the word of God, which is spirit and which is life, then it quickens you and does what God has ordained for it to do in that particular situation in your life. And if you keep taking the word of God in, the word of God in the Bible says, wherewith shall a man make his way pure? So you are struggling with immorality. You are struggling with impurities. You are struggling with lust. You are struggling with impure thoughts. And the psalmist said, so how will a young man make his way? Because know that the problem of young men is impurity. Say, by taking heed according to his word. We see that the word of God is his sanctifying agent. So many things that the word of God does. But let us settle down first and foremost that if God is going to help your life in every ramification, in every area, if you're going to be healed, delivered, transformed, if you're going to be made to be a teacher and a preacher of the word of God, if you are going to be fitted to be an administrator of the work of God, if you are going to be fitted to do good in your generation, friend, the word of God is the first matter it must train you. After he has redeemed you, after he has healed you, after he has saved you, the word of God must train you and transform you. And then the word of God must equip you. Then you will be a comprehensive minister of the word of God. And then if God is going to let miracles, healings, deliverances, word of knowledge, the gift of the Holy Ghost manifest through your life, then they will have a proper environment with which to flow. So I want to beg you, if we must reach your goal, if you must become the inheritor of your inheritance, if you must have a good marriage and a good home, if you must live a very wonderful life under the grace of God, then the word of God is indispensable. To neglect it and be looking for something here and there is a great mistake. Whenever God wants to help any man, what God does is to send his word. When God does not want to help you, just turns away his face from you, he doesn't send you his word. Bible said there's a famine that is too difficult. See, the famine of no rain. Where there's no rain, that famine, no problem. It will rain will come one day. In the meantime, you can be eating whatever, you can be eating roots. You will survive. But when God puts you under the famine of the word of God, and the word of God stops coming to your life, and you don't hear the word of God in your heart, oh, I'm sorry for you. Nothing good will happen to you. You will be like a shrub in a desert land. So can I beg you, let's make up our mind that the basic matter of life, the most important matter of life, is to hear God and have His word planted in our heart, and let us live according to the word by obeying it and practicing it. Then God will do whatever He wanted to do with your life, and your life will become a testimony that this is a man that God has shown His favor. When they say God bless you, God show you His favor, what they are saying, they understand that God send this man your word. Otherwise, it's going to be a magic. Otherwise, it's going to be arbitrary. They say, we don't understand how this one happened. But if it's the word of God that God sent to you, and you experienced a miracle, you experienced something that is uncommon, then you can say, when the word of God came to me like this, and I received it into my heart, and I began to apply, then the word of God makes soon. Each time God wants to heal a paralyzed man, have you noticed that Jesus will say, rise up, take up your bed, and go? And it was it's always when that person begins to obey the word of God. How can you tell a man who is paralyzed, he has a stroke, he's paralyzed, to rise up? It doesn't make sense. This man is paralyzed. He's bedridden for 38 years. And Jesus comes along and said, rise up, take up your bed, go home. And the attempt to obey, something happened. The word of God quickens. A miracle takes place. And you see the man carrying his bed and walking. It is like that. If God is going to help you, then you must make up your mind that it is the word. And you must wait for the word to come. And when the word of God comes, it doesn't go back to God void. So let us settle down. I don't like you to run hither thither again. If you look at the book of John chapter 5, the Bible says, and I wish we can look at this story, because it will make your faith to spring up. The Bible says in verse 1, and there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. And there is at Jerusalem, by the sheep market, a pool which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having 5 porches. In this lay a great multitude of impotent folk, of blind, of halt, of withered, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. Whoever then first after the troubling of the water stepped in was made whole of whatever disease he had. And a certain man was there which had an infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had been now a long time in that case, he said unto him, will thou be made whole? The impotent man answered him, sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me into the pool, but when I am coming, understepped down before me. Jesus said to him, rise, take your bed and walk. And immediately the man was made whole and took his bed and walked. And on the same day was the Sabbath. Hallelujah. This is a very interesting story. I wish we had time. But you know, you have seen the scenario. There's a place where impotent men, cripples, crippled by situations and crippled by the enemy, they were all lying down there. Men that are not productive. Men that their life has, their testimony is terrible. They can't do much. And in that place, there is a magic that normally happens there. Let me call it like that. This water will just shake. And the first man that jumps in, he was healed. And so everybody brought somebody there. And all of them stood at the edge, waiting to jump in so that they will be the first. And this man was lying down far away from the edge because no man was ready to carry him. He was bedridden for 38 years. And Jesus came along. I thought Jesus would go to the place where people are struggling. He went around and said, this man, do you want to rise up from your bed? He said, I've been here for 38 years. I don't have anybody to help me again. My people have abandoned me. I have no man. He said, yes, you are the candidate for this miracle. And he gave man instruction. Rise up, take your bed, and go. And the Bible says, immediately a man was made whole and took his bed. And it was in the attempt to rise up that the word of God And that will become your case. God sent his word to that man. And that word did something to that man, because that word is not the empty words. It is spirit and it is life. And life came. And it must have been a terrific wonder. 38 years of being bedridden. So, as I pray with you again, I don't care what your trouble may be. I have confidence in God and his word, that if you will apply the word of God, if you will hear him and apply his word, your situation will change. Doesn't matter what it is. So, shall we pray again? All you need to do is to remember that you must say to God, I have no man. I have no man. I'm looking up to you. I'm trusting you, because he's looking for somebody who is not on edge, who is actually looking up to him. When a man lies down, he looks up. But that man didn't even know when his help came. But your help has come, friend. Let's pray together. If you will turn to him now in repentance and it's true evil and say, Lord, here am I, bedridden. Here am I, helpless. Here am I, crippled. Here am I, an impotent man. Will you leave me like this to die in this condition? I have no man. If a man cannot help me, then you are qualified. Father, please look at that man. Look at that lady now who is saying to you, I've tried everything. I've been abandoned. Human beings have been my clutches before, but they now laid me on the ground. They are tired of me, but my case is not, you're not tired of my case. Speak your word to me, into my life, and help me to receive a miracle now. Thank you, because I know I will overcome, and I will see your hand. In Jesus' name we pray.